please welcome to the stage Jen Groover.
Thank you. Thanks so much. Good evening, everyone. I love the energy. It's so good to see so many of you. Every time I'm at a USANA event, it is literally like a family reunion to me. And it's so good to see everyone growing through the different months and years and the changes that they're making and the impact that they're making. And when I'm speaking and knowing how valuable your time is and how you've invested time away from other things in your life to be here, my intention is always to change as many lives as possible. I want you to leave the room feeling like that was the best investment of my time. So in order to do that, to give you that intention, I have to give you everything that I could possibly give you. So that you can walk out of this room tonight and say, I'm really glad we went over. And I got a lot out of that. So we're talking about a topic that I'm really passionate about. Before we go into the topic, I have a question that I would like everyone to be very honest about. How many of you are living to your fullest potential in every aspect of your life at this very moment? Raise your hand. Great. All right, so good. We have some work to do. How many of you would like to live to your fullest potential in every aspect of your life? Would that change your life? What would that look like? And you don't have to shout it out, but I want you to think about that. What does that look like? If you're maximizing your potential in every single aspect of your life, what does that look like? What do your relationships look like? What do your finances look like? What do your friendships look like? What does your health look like? What does your energy look like? Think about that clearly, because I want you to make that part of your intention, of what you're taking out of this to move forward. So today we're talking about a topic called emotional intelligence. So before I get started in telling you what I believe emotional intelligence is, I always want to know what people think emotional intelligence is. So a couple people, what to you is emotional intelligence? Being in touch with your feelings, definitely part of it. Anyone else? Being aware and managing your emotions. Definitely part of it, yes. Not letting emotions dictate your actions. Confidence, awareness of other people's emotions, yes. Yes, leaders lead with emotional intelligence. Correct, being able to cope with life stresses. Being intentional in everything that you do. Oh, I love that someone said that. That one's a big one. Starting to learn your triggers and understanding your triggers. Now, how many of you are masters at all these things that we just said here? Would you like to get closer to mastery level? Okay. So that's what we're going to dive into today. So my definition of emotional intelligence is a little bit more complex. It definitely is a sense of self-awareness. But it's about self-awareness in every aspect of your life. And one thing is not separated from the other. Everything is interconnected. Every choice you make, every action, every thought is interconnected to your ability to maximize your potential through emotional intelligence. So I've been talking about emotional intelligence for many, many years, but it just recently became cool. I just posted something the other day about my PBS special because it came up in my Facebook memory. And 4 years ago, when I had produced my PBS special, it was called Empowered. Now, I was teaching the principles of emotional intelligence, but I could have never, ever called it emotional intelligence back then because it wasn't cool. It wasn't trendy. As a matter of fact, when I would tell people how important it was to learn, when I'd go to corporations, they'd say, oh, we don't really want to learn that skill set. We just want you to teach people how to be better salespeople. Wait, that's what I'm telling you. In order to teach them to be better salespeople, they have to learn this skill set. And it was considered a soft skill set until this magical moment happened 3 years ago. This magical moment was like Christmas morning for me. On the front cover of Harvard Business Review, it says, emotional intelligence is the essential ingredient to success. The essential ingredient to success. It's a thing that we've been missing all along in the personal development space. We were skipping over so many of these very important things. Talking about motivation versus transformation. I can motivate you to do something for a short period of time if you don't change your beliefs, you don't change your why, or have an identification of your why. What are you going to do? You'll go right back to where you were. So that leads me to a point that I know for sure that so many of you in this room invest in your personal development, and that is one of the most fundamental, amazing things about USANA. USANA's goal is to awaken on all levels. By the way, USANA was actually one of the earliest adopters in bringing this to the stage, emotional intelligence. I called up Lori a couple years ago and I said, we need to switch to this topic. This, I have made so many breakthroughs in, and I've witnessed so many of my clients make breakthroughs in, and we can't not share this information. And Lori said, absolutely, let's do it. And so that's what USANA wants to invest in, you maximizing your potential in every single aspect of your life. And so all of those things that you're learning, if you're not applying, then what's the point? So as I mentioned, I know a lot of you invest in personal development. But how many of you can say that you've seen the level of success increase? You've definitely seen happiness increase, I'm sure. But how many of you can say you've seen your level of success increase to the level in which you want? No hands. All right, I like it. Everyone wants to achieve more, right? So let's break down the fundamentals of this, because when you walk away today, by the way, I'm going to give you about 8 weeks, an 8-week course of information in about the next 45 minutes. You guys good with that? So what is emotional intelligence? It affects every aspect of your life. That's why it's so important. Literally every aspect of your life, your finances, your health, your relationships, and your own personal evolution. Personal evolution is really, really important to me. It should be a priority to everybody, because basically you're saying, I want to be a better version of myself tomorrow than I was today. And I want to be a better version the next day, and so on and so forth. That's your personal evolution. And so none of these things can be separated. You can't just have great health and not be working on the other aspects of your life. You can't just work and have happiness, because you're missing out on other aspects of your life. And this is what a lot of people do. They become really focused on one vertical. One of the biggest lies we're told in our society is to go to school, work hard, get a great education, and you're going to be successful. It's one of the biggest lies. And one of the biggest missing components of that is when you get your first job, work really hard and outwork everybody else, and you'll climb that ladder, and you'll become really successful. And all of a sudden, they wake up and they're about 35, 45 and say, wow, I don't even know my spouse. I don't even know my family because I was working so hard. And then all of a sudden, that's when the relationships start to fall apart. And they realize that all these relationships in their life are falling apart because they put so much energy into climbing that ladder. And one of the biggest principles that broke through for me in my life was the health of your relationships is in direct proportion to your success and happiness. The health of your relationships is in direct proportion to your success and happiness. So why aren't we teaching people in school to master their relationships before they do anything else? Because your wealth begins with all of your relationships. That is where your wealth begins. My mentor, when I was 25, said to me, Jen, your network is your net worth. Mentally, physically, emotionally, and financially, your network is your net worth. So if you don't like what it is right now, make sure you're hanging out with people that have what you want so you can rise to their level. And it wasn't about going into a networking event and handing out a bunch of business cards, right? It was about connecting with people and creating deep-rooted relationships of trust, authenticity, character-building relationships. Because those are the relationships that when I need something at this stage of my life, I can call on those people. And they're there for me because I've been there for them. And so the wealth actually begins with all of those relationships. He said to me also, you want to be one call away from anything you need. One call, not six, not four, one call. And at this moment of my life, I can honestly say I'm at one call away from anything I need. Is that working smarter or working harder? Working smarter. But it began with what first? Relationships. Now, a lot of people think relationships are hard. And I'm not just talking about intimate relationships. I'm talking about friendships and family relationships. And they're hard because people haven't learned the tools of how to be in a relationship. We were so focused on math and science and reading and all of these other things that we left out the most important thing, which is how to communicate effectively with people. How to identify our emotions. How to create depth in our relationships. Intimacy in our relationships. And when you have depth and intimacy in relationships, you have trust. And when you have trust, you can build a lot more things, including your happiness and your wealth. Oops, I'm going the wrong way. So nothing in your life is exclusive. All of these things are interconnected. So I'm going to give you an example, just to hit home the point about your relationships. Imagine you spent all this time creating this incredible presentation, and you can't wait to go get this presentation done and close this business deal that you know is going to be a game changer in your career. And as you're walking out the door, you and your partner get in a fight. And all of a sudden, your energy becomes frenetic from this fight. Your mental state changes because now you're thinking about this fight. And you walk out the door, and you get in your car, and you're trying to forget about the fight. But that person starts texting you. And then you're texting back, and then you try to put your phone away and try and regroup. And you get into the office, and your mental state now is still frenetic. Your energy is frenetic, and you're focused more on that fight than you are that pitch. Even though your PowerPoint presentation is exactly what it was last night, you go into that pitch and it bombs. Because your energy was off, and your mental clarity was off. So you leave that meeting, and you go into your office, slam the door, and your emotional compression begins to happen. And so shortly after, you go to lunch, and instead of eating salmon and a salad that you would have had, you decide that you deserve pizza and a cookie. Because emotionally, somewhere in some point in your life, pizza was a reward, and so is that chocolate chip cookie. And so you subconsciously seek to make yourself feel better through that food. Now you go back to your office after lunch, and what happens to your glycogen level? It starts to plummet. And then how do you feel? Exhausted. And then you feel like crawling under your desk and taking a nap. And then one of your friends calls you and says, hey, you want to go grab a drink after work today? And you think, yeah, I was really going to go to the gym, but yeah, going to get that drink sounds much better right now. I'm not in the right place. And then you go to a drink, and you come home late, later than planned, and now your partner is stewing because they thought you were out having fun while they were home upset. And how's that night go? And the cycle continues. Do you see how everything was interconnected and related? Do you see how every choice led like a domino to something else? That is our power of choice. We choose every step of our lives. We have the choice. We make decisions all day, every day. Those decisions are on you of what you're making to empower your life or disempower your life. Those decisions decide the next step in your domino effect. So what decisions are you making right now in every aspect of your life that's propelling you forward and not backward? I believe that you cannot teach somebody to be more successful until you teach them emotional intelligence first. It is the foundation of everything. If you do teach these things without the emotional intelligence, it is like building a house of cards with no stability. Because when the foundation is not there and life circumstances happen, which they do, then all of a sudden your house, what? Sways, falls. But if you have a solid foundation and life circumstances come at you, you become much more resilient. And so when the things are happening, you can handle them. Those obstacles become just little things that you can step over. You become more solution-driven instead of complaint-driven. You become solution-seeking. So those obstacles are opportunities for you everywhere you turn. Do you see how my perspective just changed? From victim mindset to an empowered mindset. I have a lot of people who always ask me to teach them business, different aspects of business. My number one is, hey, Jen, can you teach me how to get on TV? I can. I could teach you how to get on television. But I'm not going to teach you how to get on television until I teach you emotional intelligence first. And I'm going to tell you why. Because you're going to go into a green room in New York City. Hopefully it's the Today Show or something like that. And when you walk in the door, most likely you are not going to be greeted by a really nice person in that green room. Why? Because they're just doing what their boss did. And they think it's the right thing to do to intimidate you as you walk in the door. By the way, buyers at retailers are exactly like this too. But they're just repeating the cycle of what their boss did, so they're just doing it. And now all of a sudden you're like, oh my gosh, this person's so mean to me. I can't believe they're so mean to me, and I'm so nervous, and I only have 4 minutes on air, and where am I supposed to go, and what am I supposed to do? And what happens to your energy again? It becomes frenetic. And then you're getting ready to go on air, and all you're thinking about is how that person was mean to you in the green room, and that maybe they don't like me, and I might not come back. You didn't even go on air yet, and you've already sabotaged your next airing. How many of you have ever done that? But if you're emotionally intelligent walking into that circumstance, you know that nothing has meaning until you give it meaning. Nothing has meaning until you give it meaning. And you also know that somebody behaving that way has nothing to do with you either. So you can withstand other people's behaviors without letting it affect you. How many of you would love to live your life not affected by other people's behaviors? How many of you would like to be in situations when someone acts cranky or ignorant, rude, that it doesn't faze you at all? When someone cuts you off on the road, it doesn't faze you at all. How much more energy would you have? A lot, right? So much of our energy is wasted on the thoughts that we create in our head that aren't even real. So much of our energy is wasted on being offended by other people when it really had nothing to do with us anyway. I always teach my daughters, hurt people hurt people. Happy people don't hurt people. There's no need to. Imagine if you had learned when you were in grade school, hurt people hurt people. Would your life have been different? Do you think you might have different beliefs in who you are and what your worth is today? 1,000%. Because think about all the things somebody else projected on you that you made about you. Think about all the things that someone said negative about you, like Jen was saying, she was too short. If she didn't change her belief, then she would have never gotten to the level that she got to today to share that story. But when you learn these skill sets, these tools about emotional intelligence, you can manage your energy at your optimal level. And you can not allow other people's stuff to become your stuff. A lot of people think that emotional intelligence, you're born with it or without. So not true. As a matter of fact, we are actually all born with emotional intelligence. Happy, joyful, coming into this world as an infant. Emotional intelligence, when you're in a state of emotional intelligence, you're in a state of emotional abundance, emotional availability. You're filled with love, compassion, empathy, understanding, patience, forgiveness, just like a child coming in the world is. But what happens and how people actually lose this is through other people's projections, other people's pain, other people's beliefs. Fear, when we're in a state of fear, we're in an emotionally unintelligent state, when we're in a place of scarcity, when we're in a place of being angry, when we're in a place of being judgmental, we are in an emotionally unavailable state. We constrict, we shut down. We don't allow things in. Opportunities are right in front of our face and we can't see them because we're blinded by fear. We're blinded by judgment. And so when you get to the place of emotional availability and you can stay in that place consistently, abundance flows to you like a rapid waterfall. In every aspect of your life, it flows to you. Life flows instead of having to push. How many of you ever felt like you were just pushing your success? It's really hard, right? Pushing's not like a fun, positive thing. You're pushing to be successful. How many of you would rather flow to success? How many of you would rather all these opportunities to just come to you like a magnet on a pretty much daily basis? Yes. Everyone should have their hand raised for that, unless you really like working really hard. That's what happens. Emotional, intelligent people live at a very high frequency so that their frequency attracts opportunity. Their eyes are open because they're not living in fear, they're living in abundance. Money, by the way, doesn't just fall out of the sky, right? Money is abundant everywhere, but it doesn't just fall out of the sky. Money comes in the forms of ideas. Dr. Wentz created this company. It started as an idea, right? But then he had to take action to his idea in order to turn it into abundance. Financial abundance that not only helped him, but it helped the entire world, helped all of you. But if you look at the world that way, and you are open, your heart's open, you're not living in fear, you're living in a place of opportunity, then all these ideas come to you like crazy. I can't stop my brain. I really can't stop it. I wake up constantly in the middle of the night writing myself notes of ideas. I welcome that in. But if I'm sitting in a place of judgment and constantly trying to destroy those ideas, I wouldn't be standing right here today. So when we are born in this world, we have all these things of these tools and skill sets of emotional availability. But it's through other people's pain and projections that actually make us become fearful and constricted. We've been talking a lot about storytelling today and transparency and authenticity. And some of you know my story and some of you don't. For those who don't, I'm going to share a little bit of a background story with you so you can understand where I come from and why this is so important to me. One of my first childhood memories was one that I can't even fathom my 12-year-old twins having ever in their lifetime. My mom was from Brooklyn, New York. She was a sassy, mouthy Brooklyn, New Yorker. She took nonsense from no one. She ran campaigns for politicians. She had a TV show that put politicians on the hot seat to be a voice, to be an advocate. And my dad was from this place called Chester, Pennsylvania, which is really bad. As a matter of fact, the news doesn't ever really cover what's going on in Chester because they're afraid to go there. And my dad grew up in a very poor, emotionally unavailable family. And my mom met my dad because she came to Philadelphia to do a photo shoot for 17 Magazine. And back then, hair straightening was brand new. My mom had really kinky, curly hair. And they straightened her hair and it all fell out. Yeah, it didn't go over too well. However, my dad was the attorney that represented her in the case. And that's how they met. And my mom fell madly in love with my dad, who was this charismatic, fun, great time guy, until she got into the marriage and realized that he was a functioning alcoholic and extremely abusive, physically and mentally and emotionally abusive. By the way, my mom's uncle was Vince Lombardi. So my mom had tenacity and strength. She was programmed with all these ideas and beliefs very young. However, once she was in this relationship, her morals of how she thought she was living her life and how her life became were completely different. She was beaten down so bad, physically and mentally and emotionally, as I mentioned, that she withered away in her strength. As I started to mention, one of my first memories as a child was when I was 4, and I watched my dad throw my mom down a flight of stairs to a cement floor. And I watched as he locked the door. Underneath the door, my brother and I could see a pool of blood just going bigger and bigger. And luckily, my mom taught my brother, who's only 11 months older than me, that if something happens to me, dial 0. And here's the address. And luckily, my brother remembered this address as a 5-year-old child. And my mom, the ambulance came, the police came. And so much of my childhood was that level of experiences. And when I was going into 8th grade, I caught my dad cheating on my mom. And I was like, yes, this is awesome, because now she can leave. So I had to address it with her, and I said, Mom, now that Dad is cheating on you, you can go. You can be free. And she said, I've known all along, but it's easier to stay than it is to go. And I said, there's no way. It can't be easier to stay. Staying is not good. It's terrible. Unfortunately, she was right. My dad was the divorce administrator of the county, and not one attorney would represent my mom. And the stress of the entire experience made her have a massive stroke. And then she had another one when I was a sophomore in college, and she lived in a wheelchair for the rest of her life. But it was during that time period when all of this was happening that I made my own contract that pretty much changed the course of my life. Remember I started off with saying my intention is? Your intentions are so powerful. My intention was never, ever to allow someone to control my happiness or finances. My intention really became a contract much bigger than me, because it wasn't about me doing it just for me. It became what I did and felt most fulfilled and purposeful to do for the world. And that's why I stand here today and is why I'm so passionate about this. The level of stress that I witnessed my mom living through kills, literally kills people. And we endure stress every day and don't even know how to manage it. We don't understand our worth, so we allow other people to destroy it more deeply. We don't stand in our own power and we become victims. And then all of a sudden we wake up and we're 80 and we say, whoa, that was life? That was living? I believe that life is meant to be lived to its fullest. I believe in creating my life exactly the way that I want it to be. I believe everyone, has the power to do that. My brother, by the way, I mentioned, is only 11 months older than me. He became a victim. We're only 11 months apart, same childhood, same experiences. He became a victim. He became very angry. He had many relationship falters, one after the other after the other. He became very much withdrawn from the world. And as I mentioned again, very angry. He didn't process his emotions. I went to college and I studied psychology because that's what most people do when they have dysfunctional childhoods. Try and figure out what it all meant. And when I studied psychology, I was like, wait, every single person in the world should be learning this stuff right now. Every single person should learn about effective communication and positive reinforcement and how to handle our thoughts, control our minds, control our emotions. And I knew in that moment that that was something that I wanted to be teaching the world. Emotional intelligence as a terminology just was born at that time period. The most successful people work on themselves first, because when you master yourself, you master your life. You are the only thing that stands you in the way between you getting what you want. Your beliefs in yourself, your understanding in yourself. I say to people all the time, how many people are emotionally intelligent? highly emotionally intelligent. So many, I know you are, Sergio. And a lot of times they're like, oh, I know all that. So I know myself inside and out. Inside and out. And then all of a sudden, next thing you know, they're like screaming at somebody. They're caught up in someone else's drama. They're having a fight with this person over there. They're having a temper tantrum about something not going right at work. And I go, oh, yeah, I might want to work on that a little bit more. It's an ongoing practice. It's a deepening of a practice. I joke with people that just when I think I've mastered it, life gives me another challenge. Because it's in the challenges that we get our test to see if we pass to the next level. So when a challenge comes, I don't get mad. I actually embrace it like, okay, cool. Now I get to go to the next level, just like in a video game. Get to the next level. So I welcome obstacles as an ability to test my strength of my growth. I don't want negative things to happen, but when they do, I see it as an opportunity to apply my knowledge, to apply my wisdom. When you maximize your potential, then you can maximize the potential in others. What is a great leader all about? Others. A great leader maximizes the potential in everybody that's following them. Jen, you heard Jen say that her coach believed in her more than she believed in herself. How many of you have people on your team that you see potential in and you're working with them because you want to see them get to that next level? And the next level, that's being a leader of service, encouraging, uplifting, bringing a mirror to show them, a magnifying glass, and quite honestly, being very truthful in that process with them. The purpose of emotional intelligence is that we can then understand how much we can control our lives. Every aspect of our lives is in your control. You can take a screenshot of this if you want as a reminder. But this is my culmination of the definition. But emotional intelligence isn't a thought process. It's a being. It's a way of being. It's a way of living. It's affected by so many aspects. It's not a thought process. It's an approach to your way of living. Emotionally intelligent people approach life very intentionally and very strategically. It's addressing that personal development isn't about motivation. It's about transformation. If every Friday night I went to my grandmom's house and she gave me pizza and ice cream, and I felt very safe and very loved there. And then, as I got older, what would happen every time I felt stressed? I would crave pizza and ice cream. The diet industry will fall apart as a whole when people start to really get this. When you can identify the emotional trigger and where it came from. So when my childhood was the craziness that it was, sugar was my drug. I went to sugar every time I wanted that chemical reaction to cope. And I became a sugar addict. I swear I became a fitness competitor because every time you tell someone you're a fitness competitor, they look you up and down, and I needed my vanity to control my willpower. But when you approach something by transformation, identifying that. Once I identified that that was the root of my cause, that sugar addiction happened because of my childhood and I could change my relationship with it, I would never want to crave sugar again. It was when my daughters were born, by the way, and I'd been completely sleep deprived for a very long time. And I took energy management for granted up until that point in my life, right? In your 20s, you're like, I'll just sleep whenever. I don't have time for that. Well, after doing it for a really long time and not sleeping, I understood how powerful sleep was to your memory, to your brain. And so I took my daughters, they started preschool, and I took my daughters to preschool one day, and I finally felt like I was getting back into my groove. No pun intended. And I went back to my office, and I was like, yes, I have this to-do list. I'm going to check it off, and I'm going. How many of you know those days where you're, like, in the zone? And you're like, yes. And I took, like, a Polaroid picture of that feeling because I wanted to be there all the time again. And I went to my daughter's school at lunchtime for a Halloween party. And at the Halloween party, I ate the icing off the top of the cupcake. Just the icing, because that was the true sugar, right? Got back to my office, felt like taking a nap right after I got back. All my energy, all my tenacity, all of my pure assertiveness and creativity went out the window. And in that very moment, I changed my entire relationship with sugar. And I thought to myself, that cupcake stole my energy. And I was angry at the cupcake for stealing my energy because it was so valuable to me at that moment. And at that time period, I changed my entire relationship with that food from a coping thing to, hey, that's going to steal my energy. That's a sabotager. I walked into Disney with my girls, not this trip to Orlando, but a couple years ago, and there was this room filled with the breakfast food, and it's filled with like donuts and cupcakes, not cupcakes, muffins and pastries. And I walk in and I think, how on earth are these people going to actually go through Disney all day today? I'd be exhausted. But I transformed. I didn't use motivation. I transformed, and you could put an entire table full of sweets in front of me and I could care less. True change is about transformation. If you're not getting the results that you want in your life right now, you need to become very aware of the things that are holding you back. Get to the root of what is holding, where it came from, in order to change it moving forward. Emotional intelligence is the awareness of, it is not intellect that moves you forward, it is wisdom. Our kids in school are learning how to regurgitate information. That's not what causes change. Wisdom, applied information, that's what causes change. That's how our kids will move to the next generation further than we are. By teaching them how to think, how to be introspective, how to take information and not just believe it, question it, question everything, and then turn it into their own information. Everything I'm teaching you with emotional intelligence is not at all the way any of my counterparts teach it. Because they're teaching it from a thought process. I'm teaching it from my experiences as a fitness competitor, learning physiology and nutrition, as someone who has studied quantum physics, as someone who has studied psychology, as someone who has studied Buddhism. And I'm wrapping all those things together into an understanding based on my own thought processes, using the wisdom that came through me through these experiences. Emotionally intelligent people work very smart instead of really hard. Now, I'm not saying don't go work and build your business, but I'm saying to be very strategic in how you do it. Optimize your energy, optimize your brain, take your supplements, make sure that your gut's healthy. And then you will work smarter instead of harder. You'll leverage your assets differently. Remember, your assets start with your what? Relationships. And you'll think more strategically and you'll build, and you won't be coming from a fear-based mindset, so you'll be building with teams more effectively, more collaboratively, because you won't think, oh no, I'm gonna do that and they're gonna take it. You're gonna think, if I build that, we will build together. 100% of $100 is still $100. 20% of $100 million is a heck of a lot more money, right? But could you build a $100 million company on your own? No, you need people to do that. And the scarcity mindset is what holds people back, those fears. As I mentioned, it is the entire foundation to build everything upon. You can take also a shot of this if you like, and list the things that it decreases and increases. I'm going to go through it really quickly. It decreases obesity. Why? I just taught you the emotional connection. Most obesity is driven by emotions. There's only 1% that there's a real disease where somebody actually can't feel satiated, and that's a genetic thing. But if everyone learned emotional intelligence, we could eradicate obesity. Stress and anxiety. If you know how to not be offended by other people, you know how to process your emotions, do you think you're going to be less stressed? And if you're less stressed, do you think you're more productive? Do you think you're more creative? Creativity, by the way, is your unlimited capital. Creativity is your unlimited capital. Desire to become the most creative person you can be, because then you're strategic, and that's where you create your own capital opportunities. Mental clutter. I mentioned emotionally intelligent people make choices to optimize their physiology so that they can optimize their psychological state and their mental state. How many of you have ever felt mental clutter before? Does it feel good? Okay, this is what I'm talking about, working smarter than harder. You could be working 80 hours that week but not being productive. But if your brain is optimized, then you're going to be thinking clearly, and then you're going to do a lot more quickly. Drama, as all of you know that know me, I live in the drama-free zone. I don't want anyone bringing their drama into my space because it sucks the life out of me. It's wasted energy. Emotionally intelligent people live in the drama-free zone. Not that I won't help somebody, but I will only help people that really do want to help themselves. I don't want to help the people that are constantly just coming to me with the same complaint over and over and over again and not making the changes. It decreases fighting and bullying. It decreases divorce and family separations, or at least amicable divorces. It decreases alcoholism, drug abuse, and all addictive behaviors. By the way, I believe in working with thousands and thousands of people in healing through emotional intelligence that addiction is an external manifestation of internal pain. External manifestation of internal pain. Happy people aren't numbing themselves. There's no need to. Or they are, they're numbing themselves with joy. My dad became an alcoholic because he was in a family that was abusive and unloved. It was part of the cycle, and he just repeated the cycle. We all can break the cycle. I broke the cycle. It was very intentional. You can break any cycle. And emotional intelligence increases our health and wellness. It increases our productivity. It increases innovation, happiness, finances, life fulfillment, world peace, literally world peace. If everyone learned how to be more empathetic, compassionate, understanding, and not take offense to other people's stuff, do you think we'd have world peace, at least at a different level? I'll tell you what, the political things that have been happening have definitely tested many people's level of emotional intelligence. And I can watch and I can see who is in the place and who's not. But we could literally have world peace if everyone learned this. It increases your safety to learn, to thrive, relationship satisfaction, and effective communication skills. How many of you think you will be more successful in every aspect of your life if you increased that right side? Absolutely. Do you think you'd hit your goals more quickly this year? Absolutely. So it begins with mindfulness, and we're going to go really quickly through the rest of this because my time's running out. Mindfulness of our health, our exercising, all these things affect our emotional intelligence. If you're not healthy, are you optimizing your emotional intelligence? Absolutely not. So we want to prioritize our health to support our physiological state, to support our mental and emotional state. Exercise. People. Now, I know that there are certain family members that you can't completely escape from if you want to. But you can change their expectations around what you expect them to be like. And once you do that, you'll change your results. People that you surround yourself very much dictate your belief and view of the world. That's why that saying, you are the five people you surround yourself with the most. So if you're not happy in the state that you are and you want to get to the next level, find people at the next level. When you learn emotional intelligence, I always tell people this in my courses. Once you learn emotional intelligence, don't go ask advice from someone who's not emotionally intelligent. Because you will get ego advice versus emotionally intelligent advice. I know there's a handful of you that have done intensive emotional intelligence training with me. Please stand up for a second. Now look to these people. First of all, give them a round of applause. And I say give them a round of applause because they prioritized this learning and this application to their life at such a high intensive level that all of them keep coming back and doing it over and over and over again because you keep deepening the practice and keep mastering it. Now, remember those people that were standing up? If you want to ask advice and want to get emotionally intelligent advice from your peers, find them. Because they'll be able to give you a perspective that's really powerful. Foods, obviously, we heard a lot about foods and how it controls our happiness, our state, our mental clarity, right? So if you're not eating healthy, what's happening to your emotional state? It's going down. If you're not supplementing and going through gut health, where is your energy at? It's down. So your emotional state is down. Your thoughts. Most depression is not clinical depression. Most depression is caused by us repeating negative thoughts over and over and over again in our mind. And when somebody comes to me and says, I keep repeating this over and over again, do you know what I say to them? Stop. Stop doing it then. Well, but I keep doing them because, stop. You have control of your mind. So stop, change it, reframe it, create a new belief system. What you watch on television affects your emotional intelligence, by the way. Things that you watch, read, music, all of these things affect your emotional intelligence. That's a good checklist for you. As we master our emotional intelligence, we increase our self-awareness to a level in which we can intentionally create a higher consistent frequency. The higher your frequency, you will become a more effective magnet for what? Good things. We do this by prioritizing in emotional intelligence. The number one thing is identify your beliefs and change the ones that no longer serve you. Unfortunately, a lot of people can't see some of the beliefs that are in their subconscious mind. So they have to dig deeper, and that's part of the process. Nate said earlier when he was on stage, he came, he was fired up last year, and then all of a sudden, what happened? His business went down because he didn't do what? Believe in himself enough to get to that next level. Not because he's lazy, because I'm sure all of you have seen Nate's workouts. They're like some of the craziest workouts I've ever seen. But because he didn't believe in himself to take the next level, so he had to change his beliefs in order to change his results. We also begin it by harmonizing all of our relationships. Make that a number one priority when you leave here today. Forgive anyone that you haven't forgiven yet because they don't even care that you're mad at them. That's why you're mad at them, right? So forgive them, truly forgive them and move on. They're only stealing your energy. They don't even care. They're off living their life happy or unhappy, but either way, that's not your problem. And the third thing is, and I've talked about this over and over again, we want to optimize our physical state so that we can optimize our mental and emotional state. USANA supplies the supplements, supplies the community, supplies education, so no one has any excuses, right? This is a quote by Einstein that is so spot on of how you should live your life. Everything is energy, and that's all there is to it. Match the frequency of the reality you want, and you cannot help but get that reality. There is no other way. Now, how many of you, knowing this, will optimize your physiological state moving forward? Awesome. How many of you will detox the drainers in your life? And then you will increase the enhancers, right? So I'm just going to go this quickly. My time's up, and I know Jordan's probably ready to hook me, and you guys are probably starving. But what holds people back from moving forward is our fears, our old patterns that we don't change because we don't understand the beliefs. We create self-sabotaging cycles over and over again. We all know those people. I know it's no one in this room. Our ego. As Michael Kahaya says, your ego is not your amigo, and it is so spot on. A lot of people think your ego drives you forward. It only self-sabotages. Ego is an equivalent to fear. People that dedicate themselves to being the best version of themselves every day to optimize who they are, those are the people that win. Those are the people that are successful. Self-limiting beliefs hold us back. Identify what your self-limiting beliefs are and change them. Anger, pain, that's why I said forgive, that holds you back. It's a huge energy depleter. Your vision or lack thereof. I want you to expand your vision beyond what is comfortable for you now. I challenge all my students to do 10 I ams and say those 10 I ams all day, every day. And those I ams need to be profound and powerful and scary. And I tell them to do it with a voice recorder, and I actually have the voice recorder playing as they're saying it, because it raises the vibratory level. So it becomes more powerful on a cellular level. Create your vision so big, create your goals so big, that it's scary for you. Your self-worth and self-respect, if you don't find worth within yourself, you're never going to achieve it. Culture and environment, commitment to change, and again, our beliefs. There's a little neuroscience that I was going to go through for you. One last thought is there's only one thing that we have control of in this world. One thing only, and it is our perspective. That is it. We can't control what anyone else is doing. We can't control anything that's happening outside of us. But we can control how we choose to see it. I choose to see all circumstances as an opportunity. I choose to see the best in everything because it does not serve me to find the worst. And when you control your perspective, you can change your ability to have more opportunities because you're seeing the positive in everything instead of the negative. This I would like you to take a shot of, to take with you. This is the emotional intelligence checklist. When you're about to react or respond to somebody, I want you to stop, take a pause, take a deep breath, and say, why do I feel this way? That's emotional awareness. And then I want you to say to yourself, is this really real? Or is my ego running the show right now? Usually it's the ego running the show, by the way. And then ask, where is it coming from? What's the root? Always get to the root of the problem. I had this experience with this guy at work who would speak to me in this tone of voice that would drive me insane. It would trigger me like crazy. And I realized in wanting to react to him instead of respond to him, his tone of voice was exactly like my dad's tone of voice was when I was younger. And that's why it was triggering me. And I finally said to him, hey, listen, I know this has nothing to do with you, but I'm going to give you a playbook right now. I know that you need me to get things done for you. But when you speak to me in that tone of voice, it literally makes me just want to shut down and do nothing for you. Because it triggers something from my past. And in order to get something from me that you would like, which you'd want to, then I need you to speak to me in a tone of voice that's different, that's respectful, that's encouraging. Because then I will perform better. Could you imagine if you could get every single person in your life a playbook like that? Do you think your life would be different? That's emotional intelligence. Take another picture. Everything on the left, you want to eliminate as much as possible. Everything on the right, you want to increase as much as possible. Everything on the left is a direct opposite to everything on the right. So where you're going to a place of expectation, change it to acceptance. Where you're going to a place of judgment, look for inspiration, and so on. One more thing to share with you as a playbook to take away. When you're about to engage with someone and you want it to be more emotionally intelligent and you want to help somebody or you want to get to the source, our goal is to understand another person. We talked about storytelling today and how important it is. When you can help understand another person, then you can help them get what they want. Isn't that what USANA is all about? Helping people get what they want? But if you attack somebody and you say, you're not doing this, you're not showing up at meetings, you're not making enough calls, what does that person do? They shut down. They withdraw. They become defensive. But if you start by saying, I'm feeling this way, whatever way, disappointed, I'm taking responsibility for my feelings. I'm feeling this way based on my perception, because it is only my perception, it's not the truth. Based on my life experiences, because all perception is created by past experience. I could totally be wrong. So I would love if you could show me a different perspective so I can understand you better. Do you think that would help build your teams more effectively? Do you think that would help people trust you more as a leader? Do you think that would help people share more with you as a leader? Absolutely. So I post about this stuff all the time. So if you want to follow on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, I'm very active. I post tons of articles so you can keep deepening your learning. And you can even text at 444-999, the word empowered, and I'll send you these slides so you can keep going through it. There's some things I obviously didn't get to and I fast forward through them. But if you text at that number, I'll make sure to send out an email this week that has all the slides in them so you can keep going through them and keep be reminded of different things that you want to apply to your life. I appreciate your time. I am so excited that you're all here. I look forward to talking to you more throughout the weekend. Thank you very much. Have a great night, everybody. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks.